Hi, welcome to Tradition Today. I'm your host, Father David Smith. Today we start a four-part series on the Jesus Prayer. Now, I've already done a program entitled Your Prayer Rope, which is the device we use when we pray the Jesus Prayer. But in this series, we're going to take a step back from the prayer, back from the rope to the prayer itself. In part one, we're going to examine the biblical and the historical background of the prayer. In part two, we're going to look at the various elements of the prayer and what the Jesus Prayer is not. Part three, we'll look at some of the church's writings on the Jesus Prayer. And in part four, we're going to look at the Jesus Prayer in the context of the culture, in the context of the church, and in the context of our individual lives. So let's get started. In the Holy Scriptures, we find that the retreat from society is a spiritual practice that extends back to the earliest days of mankind's dealings with God. We'll begin with Moses, who did not flee to the desert in order to find God, but in order to escape the consequences of a crime he had committed. In Exodus chapter 2, we learn that the Pharaoh, in whose house Moses lived, wanted him killed for the crime of murdering an Egyptian who was beating a Hebrew slave. Moses fled to the wilderness, and there God called him. This is the beginning of Exodus chapter 3. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Here we see that God needed Moses to get away from the activities and the passions of Pharaoh's house in order to hear his voice. Could God have spoken to Moses in the palace? I don't know, but I do know that he spoke to Moses in the wilderness. During this series, we will regard the Jesus Prayer as an opportunity for us to get away from worldly things and withdraw, as it were, into the wilderness. When Saint Simeon the New Theologian wrote about his spiritual journey, speaking of himself in the third person as a man named George, he talked about living a busy and elegant life during the day and going to his home at night to spend, at times, the entire night in prayer. Quote, during the day, he was in charge of a patrician's household, and each day he went to the palace, engaging in the tasks demanded by such a life, so that no one was aware of his other pursuits. Every evening, tears flowed from his eyes. He multiplied the prostrations he made with his face to the ground, his feet together, and rooted on the spot where he stood. He prayed assiduously to the Mother of God with sighs and tears, and as though the Lord himself was physically present, he fell at his most pure feet, while, like the blind man, he besought mercy, unquote. That's from the fourth volume of the Philokalia. See how this life of adoration and repentance took place away from people and busyness. This is why I say that the history of the Jesus prayer starts in the saints of the Old Testament, like Elijah, when the great prophet had defeated and slain the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. The Queen Jezebel made an oath that she would find Elijah and punish him with death. What a terrible turn of events for Elijah, who had just accomplished this great miracle, showing people that God was the only one and true God, to be rewarded by having to flee for his life. This is how the story continues. This is from 1 Kings 19 in Protestant Bibles. In the Orthodox Bible, it's Third Kingdoms. Quote, "But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree. And he prayed that he might die and said, 'It is enough. Now, Lord, take my life, for I am no better than my father's.' Then, as he lay and slept under the broom tree, suddenly an angel touched him and said to him, 'Arise and eat.' And then he looked, and there by his head was a cake baked on coals and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, 'Arise and eat, because the journey is too great for you.' So he arose and ate and drank, and he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights as far as Mount Horeb, the mountain of God. And there he went into a cave and spent the night in that place, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him." Unquote. This is followed by the story about how the Lord speaking to Elijah, not in a tornado, not in an earthquake, not in a fire, but in a calm breeze. Notice, if you will, that the place this happened was the same mountain where Moses met the Lord, Mount Horeb. In this series of Tradition Today videos, I call you to a place where thousands of God seekers have found the calm breeze, in the quiet, in the wilderness, the place you will find yourself as experiencing nothing less than holy ground, the Jesus Prayer. You might be asking how a spiritual practice called the Jesus Prayer could be connected to the saints of the Old Testament. St. Gregory Palamas, in his Hagaritic Tome, it's a work that we'll discuss a little later, said this, quote, "Teachings that today are daily discussed and common knowledge to all, that are proclaimed with complete freedom, were at one time the mysteries of the Mosaic Law and foreseen in the spirit only by the prophets," unquote. The teaching he's talking about is the Jesus Prayer, which the prophets knew about and practiced even before the incarnation of God in Jesus Christ. It was and is, after all, the same Holy Spirit. Another biblical figure who found God in the wilderness was St. John the Baptist. As St. Luke's Gospel tells us, this is in chapter 1, "So the child grew and became strong in spirit and was in the deserts till the day of his manifestation to Israel," unquote. St. John the Baptist found God in the desert and continued to live there while people made their way out to him to hear his teaching. And what was his teaching? It really consisted of one word, repent. The teaching of God that came to St. John and brought hundreds and thousands of people out to hear him and be baptized by him can be summed up in one word: repent. And this is also the core of the Jesus prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me. We ask for mercy because we need mercy. We've done, we've said, we've thought things for which we need forgiveness. And it's the Jesus prayer that keeps us always in touch with that reality. Jesus often told his followers, and through the words of Holy Scripture, us, that our prayers ought to be short and to the point. As in St. Matthew's Gospel, this is chapter 6. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. What's the most powerful tool that we have as Christians? The name of Jesus, given by the angel to Joseph, quote, "For he will save his people from their sins," unquote. We'll talk more another time about the specific words used in the Jesus prayer, but I will tell you now that there are writings from the church fathers that say the Jesus prayer simply consists of the word Jesus. My favorite writer from the Philokalia talks about this, Saint Ezechias the priest, in his work entitled On Watchfulness and Holiness. Quote, "The more the rain falls on the earth, the softer it makes it. Similarly, Christ's holy name gladdens the earth of our heart the more we call upon it," unquote. I love that sentence because the spiritual life and the use of the Jesus prayer is an exercise, and we make good use of it when we see it that way. If you exercise once a month or so, you run a little, you lift a weight or two, you're never going to see any benefit. So too with the name of Jesus. It's like a steady rain that softens and soaks the earth. Quote, "We have learned from experience that for one who wishes to purify his heart, it is a truly great blessing constantly to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus against his intelligible enemies." Notice how what I speak of from experience concurs with the testimony of Scripture. It is written, "Prepare yourself, O Israel, to call upon the name of the Lord your God." And the apostle says, "Pray without ceasing," unquote, and so on. What are the enemies Saint Ezechias speaks of? He's talking about a wandering mind. He's talking about inattentiveness, slothfulness, and sin. These are defeated using the weapon and the name of Jesus. This part of Ezechias reminds me of another great teacher of the spiritual life, St. John Climacus, when he says in step 21 of his Ladder of Divine Ascent, quote, "Flog your enemies with the name of Jesus, for there is no stronger weapon in heaven or earth." Flog your enemies with the name of Jesus. What a great line. And since we've started to look at some of the patristic teachers on the Jesus prayer from the Philokalia, as anybody must who desires to be a student of prayer, let's familiarize ourselves with two of the great ones, St. Gregory of Sinai and St. Gregory Palamas. St. Gregory of Sinai is called this because he took his full monastic profession on Sinai in Egypt, although the more prominent locations in his story are Crete, where he probably learned the Jesus Prayer, and Mount Athos, the center of the Orthodox world that he influenced so profoundly while he was there, and Bulgaria, where he established his own monastery and where he died. His dates are 1265 to 1346, so he lived at the decline of the Byzantine Empire, the Catholic sack of Constantinople in 1204 occurred 60 years before his birth, and the actual demise of the empire happened in the mid-15th century, 100 years after his death. But it was not a peaceful time to be alive, and this is the reason that St. Gregory of Sinai moved from place to place. We know that while he was at the monastery in Crete, he learned, here I'm quoting from his biographer, quote, "the guarding of the intellect, true watchfulness, and pure prayer," unquote. So when he left Crete, St. Gregory went to the Holy Mountain, probably around the turn of the century, with his interest in the Jesus Prayer already established. He couldn't find a monastery where they were practicing and learning hesychasm. The word actually just means stillness, and it's a way of describing the practice of the Jesus Prayer. And so he spent all his time there in a small hermitage with just a few other monastics. Although hesychasm had always been a feature of spiritual life on Mount Athos, St. Gregory of Sinai was one of the fathers from this period that strengthened the practice of hesychasm on the mountain and throughout the whole Orthodox world, to the extent that even controversy started, as they do with anything that's successful, which we're going to address when we look at St. Gregory Palamas. It seems that St. Gregory of Sinai didn't get into the disputing that arose around the Jesus Prayer, but spent all his time learning, teaching, and practicing hesychasm. When he left the mountain to go to Bulgaria, the Jesus Prayer was firmly established as the central spiritual practice of Mount Athos, and indeed of all of Orthodox monasticism, and really the entire Orthodox Church, even until today. For St. Gregory of Sinai, the practice of the prayer had a specific goal, unity with God. The purpose of the prayer was not to try to change things to one's advantage or comfort, as many Christians believe, or many Christians use prayer that way. Listen to how St. Gregory might teach you to be a beginning prayer. Quote, "For beginners, prayer is like a joyous fire kindled in the heart. For the perfect, it is like a vigorous, sweet-scented light. Or again, prayer is the preaching of the apostles, an action of faith, or rather faith itself, that makes real for us the things in which we hope. Active love, angelic impulse, the power of the bodiless spirits, their work and delight, the gospel of God, the heart's assurance, the hope of salvation, a sign of purity, a token of holiness, the knowledge of God, baptism made manifest, purification in the water of regeneration, a pledge of the Holy Spirit, an exaltation of Jesus, the soul's delight, God's mercy, a sign of reconciliation, the seal of Christ, a ray of the noetic song, the heart's dawn star, a confirmation of the Christian faith, the disclosure of reconciliation with God, God's grace, God's wisdom, or rather, the origin of true and absolute wisdom, the revelation of God, the work of monks, the life of hesychasts, the source of stillness, and the expression of the angelic state. Why say more? Prayer is God who accomplishes everything in everyone. For there is a single action of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit activating all things through Jesus Christ. Unquote. You see how prayer has, in St. Gregory of Sinai, a specific goal, unity with God and the acquisition of the wisdom of God. For St. Gregory, prayer brings about joy because it is God accomplishing in you that which you were made to accomplish. It's interesting that he calls prayer baptism made manifest. This is a major part of Gregory's teaching. What could he possibly mean by that? The energy of the Holy Spirit, which we have already mystically received in baptism, is realized in two ways. First, to generalize, this gift is revealed, as St. Mark tells us, through arduous and protracted practice of the commandments. To the degree to which we effectively practice the commandments, its radiance is increasingly manifested in us. Secondly, it is manifested to those under spiritual guidance through the continuous invocation of the Lord Jesus. It's interesting that he calls prayer baptism made manifest. What could he possibly mean by that? Quote, the energy of the Holy Spirit, which we have already mystically received in baptism, is realized in two ways. First, to generalize, the gift is revealed, as St. Mark tells us, through arduous and protracted practice of the commandments. To the degree to which we effectively practice the commandments, its radiance is increasingly manifested in us. Secondly, it's manifested to those under spiritual guidance through the continual invocation of the Lord Jesus, repeated with conscious awareness, that is, through the mindfulness of God. In the first way, it's revealed more slowly, in the second way, more rapidly, if one diligently and persistently learns how to dig the ground and locate the gold. That's from the Philokalia chapter, or volume 4. That's what we're doing in this series on the Jesus Prayer. We're digging the ground to locate the gold. St. Gregory is saying that we receive the energy of the Holy Spirit at baptism, but that we so often neglect God and the energy is lost. The only way to gain it back again is the practice of the commandments, but also by prayer. Not just any prayer, St. Gregory specifies the continuous invocation of the Lord Jesus repeated with conscious awareness. What an exciting perspective he has. When we practice the Jesus Prayer, we fulfill, we complete, we build upon the energy of the Holy Spirit that we received at our baptism. Now let's turn our attention to a very different figure, St. Gregory Palamas, the defender of hesychasm. There are many things that could be said about the life of St. Gregory Palamas, a remarkable person, and many books have been written about his life and his theology. He was, in exactly the same way as St. Gregory of Sinai, mainly a practicer of the hesychastic life. That's the important thing about St. Gregory Palamas as it relates especially to our present discussion. He differed from the other Gregory in that he learned before he arrived at Mount Athos the art of disputation. And so he rose to the role of the defender of hesychasm against the attacks of misguided theologians, a very public task that the Lord had prepared him for, a task that he performed with holiness and zeal and great success. This is not to say that St. Gregory of Palamas relished the mission the Lord gave him. Quite the contrary. He would have liked to stay quietly on the holy mountain practicing and teaching the Jesus Prayer, but he could not. As Metropolitan Herotheos Vlachos tells us, quote, "But when he was asked by his spiritual brothers, and when he himself realized that the faith was in danger of being altered, which would also have resulted in the altering of the means of man's cure, of losing the way of salvation, then he began his struggle," unquote. The struggle he's talking about is the sort of the disputation that took place with the theologians who disagreed with hesychasm. So St. Gregory began to write, defining and defending the hesychastic tradition and answering the attacks upon it. I don't want to describe all the back and forth of that controversy because it doesn't have as much to teach us about the Jesus Prayer itself as other writers and documents do. But it's important for us to talk a little bit about one particular document produced by St. Gregory as an expression of the essential elements of his theology. This short work is called the Hagiodic Tome. It was signed by the leaders of all the monasteries on Mount Athos and so had their unwavering support. This, the most important aspect of the Hagiodic Tome for us, is the teaching about the effect of grace on the body. Quote, "In the case of those who have liberated themselves from the beauties of this world for the sake of their hope in good things to come, the mind advances securely on account of its freedom from care. It senses in itself the divine and inexpressible goodness, and, according to the degree of its progress, it shares its own goodness with the body. That grace, which then comes to pass in both soul and body, is such that it comprises an unfailing reminder of the life incorruptible," unquote. Metropolitan Herotheos sums up this passage by saying, "In godly asceticism, as it is presented by the Orthodox tradition, the body too partakes of the grace of God," unquote. This is an important element of the theology of Palamas, which is the hesychastic theology of the Orthodox Church, that the body participates in and is influenced by the work of salvation. Thank you for joining us for this first video on the Jesus Prayer, in which we've looked at the biblical and historical underpinnings of the practice of the prayer. Join us for part two, in which we'll examine the parts of the Jesus Prayer itself and what the Jesus Prayer is not.